kind of you to think of me when I was out of sorts. It really meant a lot to be in someone else's thoughts, someone else's mind, someone else's kind as you. The thoughtfulness you showed has made a difference in my life. I won't forget how unafraid you were that long dark night. I thought that I was lost. I thought I'd never find a someone quite as kind as you.
Sam Wiles, as we discover the history, the music, and the man behind it all, Paul McCartney. To get in contact with the show, email us at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com.
Hello, 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 hi, and welcome to another episode of Paul or Nothing, the place to get all of your Paul all of the time. And remember, this is widescreen podcasting.
This is widescreen podcasting.
I'm, of course, your host, Sam Wiles. Thank you all for tuning in, and I hope you're all well, safe, and sound. Well, here we are once again, folks. We are having another one of these episodes that I'm oh so happy to take part in and do the research for and put out for you, because I get to speak to another author. It's something that I either do a whole lot on this show, or it seems to have like whole year gaps of intermittence in between. But yep, we are back on the literary bandwagon once again. And today we are going to be looking at Love and Let Die by John Higgs. Or should I say, Love and Let Die, Bond, the Beatles and the British Psyche. Now, if that's a title that doesn't get you going, it doesn't inflare your senses and send your mind reeling, then I don't know what title will. This is an absolutely awesome book, folks. Right off the top of the show, I'm going to say that. This is another one, like another book that's actually gotten me to read it past the interview with the author. That is always such a litmus test for me, you know, to see if a book really is good. And I am a few dozen chapters past the obligatory amount that I read before I do an interview. Yes, I have actually continued to read this book, and I've learned so much about Bond in this book. Of course, a lot of the Beatles stuff I'm already quite familiar with, but oh my god, I've learned so much about James Bond in this book, and the number of connections between Bond and the Beatles, and how many times those two stories intersect is so astounding, and it totally makes sense that a book like this exists. If any of you out there have any doubts as to what this book could contain and, you know, why it should exist as a concept, just know that Love Me Do and Dr. No were released on the same day and kind of defined the 60s. Yes, this is a book about the 60s and onwards. It's about British culture, it's about British history, the British psyche, it's about masculinity, it's about social trends, sexuality. It covers it all so brilliantly and so deftly, and there's so much research, and he writes it well. He writes it really well, and it's a speedy read, it's quite leisurely, it's not too intense, and I've really been enjoying it. And so, right here, at the top of the show, I can only give it my full recommendation. Please go out and buy your own copy of Love and Let Die, Bond, the Beatles, and the British Psyche. I'm holding my copy right here, even though I'm not on camera. But yeah, go check this out, because I've really been enjoying it. It's really fun, it's really learned, and best of all, it's a Beatles book with an actual original topic and theme, which is, oh, just so fantastic that that can still exist and can still happen, and we're still getting this sort of media. But you know what, before we get into the book itself and my interview with the author, who I loved having on the show, we had a great time together, we do need to quickly settle the matter of the
housekeeping.
And starting off with the news, what do we have for today? Well, first of all, we've got something very exciting indeed. In a recent interview with paulmccartney.com, Mac has come right out and said that there is indeed some new music on the horizon in this year of 2023. You know what? I'll just read the quote. PM.com says, "That's a great highlight of 2022, talking about Glastonbury. It was ours too. What are you looking forward to in 2023? Paul says, "Well, I'm going on holiday. I'm definitely looking forward to that. And I'm doing some more recording. I've been recording with a couple of people, so I've been looking forward to doing that even more. I've started working with this producer called Andrew Watt, and he's very interesting. We've had some fun. Beyond that, I don't have anything massively planned at the moment."
So, who knows what this means, right? Yes, it could mean a new album, but we should also temper our expectations and remember that this could range from something big, like an album, or his stage musical that he's been working on for a while, or the score for his Netflix animated movie, to something small, like a couple of collabs, or simply stocking up on songs for a future project. Hey, anything at all. I'll take any new Paul McCartney recordings, especially with the way that they get leaked these days. At best, we get an album. At worst, we get some cold cuts, like with Filmer. Also, just touching on the idea of him working with Andrew Watt, that's pretty cool. Watt is best known for his work with Justin Bieber, Miley Cyrus, and Post Malone, but he's also recently worked with other legacy artists like Elton John, Stevie Wonder, Ozzy Osbourne, Eddie Vedder, and Iggy Pop. which means that we may very well end up with a possible Greg Kurstin, Ryan Tedder situation in the near future, where the kids are going to update Paul's sound for him. For some, that may be a bad sign, but for me, it's an incredibly good one. Following on, and we have another music video HD restoration. Yes, Paul has been working his way through his back catalogue videography and updating them for a while now, most recently with Wonderful Christmas Time at the end of last year. However, on this occasion, it's for Hope of Deliverance. Now, I've not actually covered this video yet with Ed Chen in that little side series yet, but I did sneak ahead and check it out, and let me just say, I have a lot to say about it, and I can't wait to cover it with him in the future. Anyway, the important thing is that there is a video now in HD, so both you and I can enjoy it in the best resolution possible. Go and check it out. Links will be in the description down below. Moving forward, and what do we have? Oh, look, another book release. Oh, just another book release. Oh, no, wait, no. This is not just any book release. This is set to be possibly one of the biggest, most reviewed, most highly publicized releases of the year. It's a book by Macca himself, which at first made me very joyous, as I'm sure you are right now, at that news. But then you think, oh yes, this is going to be very heavy on the wallet indeed, isn't it? What is it, Sam? Let us know. Well, this is a new book by Paul McCartney, and it is called 1964, Eyes of the Storm. Here's what we know so far, and I quote, in 2022, an extraordinary trove of nearly 1,000 photographs taken by Paul McCartney on a 35mm camera was rediscovered in his archive. They intimately record the months towards the end of 1963 and the beginning of 1964, when Beatlemania erupted in the UK, and after the band's first visit to the UK, they became the most famous people on the planet. The photographs are McCartney's personal record of this explosive time, when he was, as he puts it, in the Eyes of the Storm. 1964 Eyes of the Storm presents 275 of McCartney's photographs from the six cities of these intense legendary months: Liverpool, London, Paris, New York, Washington DC and Miami, and many never before seen portraits of John, George and Ringo. In his foreword and introductions to these city portfolios, McCartney remembers "What else can you call pandemonium?" and conveys his impressions of Britain and America in 1964, the moment when the culture changed and the 60s really began. Well, folks, just as predicted, the enormous success of Paul McCartney, the lyrics, has inevitably inspired Paul to go at it again for another, what might be a yearly, bi-yearly tradition now, prestige book release, with this one looking to set you back around £60, about $100. Though, unlike Paul McCartney, the lyrics, which was focused on words and supplemented with great pictures, this seems to have taken the opposite route and is a book that is focusing on the pictures that will hopefully be supplemented by great words. 1964 In the Eyes of the Storm will be released on the 13th of June 2023, and I'll be working my ass off to make sure that I get a free press copy by that time. Yeah, of course I will. Although, if you don't manage to get a copy for yourself, the photos inside of it will be displayed at the National Portrait Gallery in London from the 28th of June to the 1st of October, so be sure to check that out if you can. So, who's excited about this? I know I am. I'm definitely going to be grabbing a copy even if I don't get that lucrative press one. Oh well. But yeah, folks, the prospect of new Beatle content, new Beatle photos, you know, they've only been discovered in the last 3 years or so. They're going to be fresh for public eyes now. How can that not be exciting? This is going to be the big Beatle release of the year in many ways. And I'm sure McCartney's going to be going for that prestigious Waterstones Book of the Year award again. You know, good luck to him in that. A very exciting release. God, there's so many good books, so many good McCartney and Beatle books coming out this year. We really are spoiled. What have we got next? Oh, yes. We come to the rather sad portion of the show now, folks. No, don't worry. This isn't Driving Rain Part 1 or anything like that. But this is an obituary segment, a McCartney-related obituary segment. Don't worry, it's not Paul himself. And this isn't going to be an official segment, and I don't want to make it a regular one, but things do seem to have a trend towards this in recent years. But yeah, Paul has made several tributes on his Twitter page after losing quite a few people in the last few weeks and months. First of all was the death of Charles Gracie. Gracie was an old rock and roll icon from Paul's youth, with such hits as the American number one Butterfly or the UK number six hit Fabulous, which Paul of course covered on the Run Devil Run album. Paul said, "Sad to hear of the death of Charles Gracie, an early rock and roll pioneer who influenced our formative years. Love to his family. Thanks, Charlie. You were fabulous. Love, Paul. Kiss." Then we had the death of iconic red-headed fashion designer Vivian Westwood. "I never even knew Paul and her were close, but even if he didn't know it before, like Stella got into, you know, fashion and being a big fashion icon, he certainly would have after that point. So it does make sense. Still, he was clearly moved enough to write, goodbye Vivian Westwood, a ballsy lady who rocked the fashion world and stood defiantly for what was right. Love, Paul. Kiss." Following on, and we have the passing of Barbara Walters. She was, of course, the famous American broadcaster and TV personality, and she actually recently came up on Reddit for all of her inappropriate questions that she asked celebrities. So I don't know how really beloved she is in the wider world and in America specifically. But anyway, she is connected to Paul, not through a past interview, but because she was the older cousin of his wife, Nancy Chaffal. So it made sense for him to pay tribute. He wrote, "Nancy and I are saddened by the news of her dear cousin Barbara Walters passing. The two of them enjoyed a deep and loving relationship over many years, and I was proud to share some of those special moments." Next, in a never-ending stream of fatalities, we had the death of Jeff Beck. Beck, as I'm sure many of you know, is a very esteemed and influential guitarist who came up around the same time as Paul. Though, the fact that Paul, along with Jimmy Page and comedian Vic Reeves, did a cover of I've Got a Lovely Bunch of Coconuts at Jeff Beck's wedding shows that they must have been pretty close indeed. Oh, what a show that must have been. But yeah, Paul said, "I was saddened to hear that Jeff Beck had died. Jeff Beck was a lovely man with a wicked sense of humour who played some of the best guitar music to ever come out of Britain." But that's not where the story ends with Jeff in this new segment, folks. As it turns out, and this likely had been brought to light because of his death, is that Beck and McCartney did actually make some music together, and it was part of a 1994 campaign against deforestation, and the song title is literally Why Are They Cutting Down the Rainforest? And this has never been known about before. It isn't in any books or anything like that. I hope Luca Perazzi has time to add this to his book before he releases it. But yeah, the audio has been released and it's been made public, and it is very interesting indeed. And let's just play it right now.
"Hello, this is Jeff Beck. Why are they cutting down the rainforest? Grazing. What worries me is what else we are killing besides the cows. Nearly a quarter of all medications and pharmaceuticals that we use today are derived from tropical plants. 70% of the plants identified as having anti-cancer agents come from rainforests. And yet, because we want more and more grazing land for cattle, we are ripping up the rainforests, uncaring or oblivious to the fact that these forests may and possibly do contain plants that can provide a cure for leukemia or heart disease. Maybe even a cure for AIDS. Who knows? But it doesn't make much sense to me to risk losing the possible discovery of a miracle cure just for $1.50 hamburger. Thanks for listening."
So yeah, as you heard there, Paul doesn't actually sing on it, but it is described as those two making music together, so I'm sure Paul is playing one, if not several, instruments on that track. It, as a spoken word piece, was quite interesting. It's probably not what most people would want from a Jeff Beck and Paul McCartney collab, but, you know, as far as curios go, it's definitely up there. That was very cool indeed. Although, sadly, that is not the end of the obituaries. We do have to go back for a brief moment, as we also had the death of Burt Bacharach. to me, the name Burt Bacharach isn't one that I really know. I don't really know any of his music, but I've always known that he was one of those big names, quote unquote, in music. And he released a ton of music in his lifetime, particularly in the 60s. And it is no wonder that McCartney was fond of him. Paul wrote on his Twitter, "Dear Burt Bacharach has passed away. His songs were an inspiration to people like me. I met him on a couple of occasions, and he was very kind and a talented man who will be missed by all. His songs were distinctive and different from many others in the 60s and 70s. When we met not too long ago, he reminded me that he'd been the musical director for Marlene Dietrich when the Beatles shared the bill with her at the London Palladium. He was a lovely man. Nancy and I send lots of love to his family. Paul." Now, lastly, I'm going to get to a name that, oddly enough, was not posted on Paul's Twitter, and that is the recent loss of David Crosby. Also, that was another big rock and roll loss we've had recently. Now, if Paul's Twitter is solely an algorithm or an intern, then I imagine it would have posted a soulless tribute to David Crosby. So if it is indeed somewhat run by Paul himself, maybe he calls someone to do it for him, then I can only conclude that Paul really didn't know David Crosby very well. I'd hate to think that they didn't like each other, but I've never heard anything like that. Anyone email in and let me know otherwise. Are there any links between the Beatles or McCartney and Crosby, or Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young, something like that? I don't know. But yeah, I did think it was odd on the day that Paul didn't post something, but I'm likely overthinking about it. So let's move right on to the next kind of major topic that has been out in the last few days. There is a new Paul McCartney documentary coming out, folks. That is always an exciting prospect as well. New McCartney specific content. You know, Paul's getting on the Get Back bandwagon. You know, if the Beatles have had a big successful doc, I should have a big successful doc as well, and I couldn't agree more. It is called Man on the Run, and it is set to be directed by filmmaker Morgan Neville, and will draw on the unprecedented access to a never-before-seen archive of Paul and Linda's home videos and photos, as well as new interviews. And from what the press release has put out, it is mostly going to focus on Wings and Paul's solo career, which, okay, if that's true, then this is going to be one of the most exciting McCartney cinematic releases ever. Like a big, prestige McCartney documentary that doesn't just focus on the Beatles. Like, imagine if both halves of George Harrison Living in the Material World were all about George's solo career. And we went, like, album by album in a little more detail, which you could do with George's discography, you know? And I don't think we're going to get an album by album one with Man on the Run, which is also the name of a McCartney book, but that's probably another topic. You know, just a little more detail on Wings and their breakup, and, you know, their tours and their albums and their songs and their hits. That could be fun, you know, for maybe like the first third of the movie, if it's going to go like that. Maybe the first half, maybe like half is going to be Wings. But, you know, a documentary that even just glosses over all of Paul's solo career from start to finish, but we get a mention of everything and, you know, the life. That's a big task, actually. I can't wait to see if he pulls it off. I don't know how far forward it's going to go. Is it going to go all the way to McCartney 3 and Rockdown? Who knows? You know, this is going to be something that we're all going to be keeping our eye on, I imagine. We're all going to be looking for updates and new articles and reviews, that kind of thing. I mean, how can you not when the press release puts out things like, "Man on the Run will serve as the definitive document of Paul's emergence from the dissolution of the world's biggest band and his triumphant creation of a second decade of musical milestones, a brilliant and prolific stretch." Okay, that makes it just sound like it's only going to be Wings. So maybe when they say solo, they mean that, you know, they're going to cover McCartney 1, Ram, and maybe like McCartney 2, maybe Tug of War. So that's probably what we should expect. I don't think we're going to be getting all the way up to McCartney 3, sadly. But yeah, this is awesome. This is fucking awesome. I'm really excited about this one. The pedigree is amazing. I really want to get this Morgan Neville guy on the show. I really feel like he would be doing interview rounds soon, so I really better get on that. But yeah, he's done so many docs, or at least his company has. You know, they've done docs on Keith Richards, Johnny Cash, even one on Taylor Swift, because everyone who I want on this show seems to have worked with Taylor Swift in some way when it comes to film stuff. You know, but yeah, you know, these are big artists. You know, he's done popular artists, he's done legacy ones, and many other documentaries of many types. And so who better to tackle the topic of McCartney than someone who is a top-tier documentary filmmaker? So how could you not be excited about this? And finally, folks, to round out this new segment, we have a style cover of Temporary Secretary. Yes, this is by the YouTube channel The Music B&B, and it is a cover of Temporary Secretary, as interpreted by The Music B&B, if Enter Shikari wrote it. Now, Enter Shikari are a rock band that were kind of big when I was a teenager. They are still going. They incorporate a lot of other elements into their music, like metal and hip-hop and stuff. They're quite eclectic. They're really not my thing. And I thought that this actually was a cover by them until I saw the title, if Enter Shikari wrote Temporary Secretary. But still, I found it to be quite interesting, worthy of mentioning at least, and I'll be playing it in full at the end of this episode. Right, that is all of the news out of the way. Let's do the plugs. Let's do it quickly, folks, because we don't have any emails this week. But if you do want to get in contact with the show, drop us an email about anything Paul McCartney related at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com. Follow us on our Twitter for daily updates, which is @McCartneyPod. You can also say hello there as well. For bonus Paul or nothing written content, check out paulmccartneypod.wordpress.com. Check us out on the socials, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube by typing in Paul or Nothing or Paul McCartney Podcast. Of course, YouTube is the place where you can check out all episodes of our sister series, Mac It In Your Attic. You really should know what that is by now. If you want to help out the show right away, please leave us some form of review, whether it's some stars, a like, a thumbs up, a tick, a comment, a share, whatever it is always appreciated. And finally, folks, if you want to help out the show more directly, more consistently, then please check out our Patreon page, where you get early access to loads of Paul or Nothing content and access to loads of hidden and unlockable Paul or Nothing content. There's loads of stuff there. There's even a unique side series that I do on there as well. I'm not doing the full explanation today, folks, because you've heard it all before, and I'll probably be doing it again next week anyway. So let's just dive right into my conversation with John Higgs about his book, Love and Let Die, The Beatles, Bond and the British Psyche. One, two, three, go me. And now, everyone, it is time for me to bring on today's esteemed guest. The man I'm speaking with today, folks, has been writing about a perfect storm of topics to get him to this particular moment and this particular release. He's written about British culture, British history, British historical and artistic figures, as well as texts detailing the last and current centuries. So when I heard that his new book was going to be called Love and Let Die, Bond, the Beatles and the British Psyche, I knew that he was going to be more than qualified to tackle such a gargantuan topic. Everyone, please welcome to Paul or Nothing, Mr. John Higgs. Hello, John. How are we doing today?
Oh, I'm doing very well, Sam. It's really nice talking to you. Hello there.
Yes, I'm so excited to have you on here today because there is so much to cover. There is genuinely, normally, I really try and pass my questions down to two good A4 pages, but I'm bordering five or six here. So I'm really going to rattle off here. We've done all the pleasant exchanges, folks, off camera. I knew I'd have to do that to keep the episode streamlined. So, you know, this is Bond and the Beatles and the British Psyche. Let's just quickly talk about the first two broadly, just so we can get a baseline for who you are and, you know, where your headset was coming into this book. Please tell me about your first memories of the Beatles.
They've always been there. Mm-hmm. They're always part of your life. So it's very hard to say when you've first discovered them. But I do have strong memories of the film Birth of the Beatles, probably in about 1979, 1980, being on the TV and watching that as a young kid.
Okay.
And just the fact that it was deemed significant enough that this band in their early days had changed their drummer. That was enough to make a film about, sort of mark them out as this is something, this is an important band, you know. It just seems such a weird thing to exist. So yeah, I think that's my first memory of
Birth of the Beatles is a 1979 American biographical film produced by Dick Clark Productions. Okay.
Mm, yeah.
Very, very interesting. I mean, TV movie.
You know, it's at primary school, they'd all sung, you know, Yellow Submarine and Yesterday, probably.
I've got those exactly.
Things like those. And it slightly ruined them for you for a while, you know, in that it was a school thing. And it took a while to sort of come around and rediscover the whole thing and how they all fitted together and what the Beatles actually were. But they were always there, basically.
What was the climate when you were a young lad growing up with the Beatles? Were we in one of those phases where they were cool or one of those phases where they were anything but?
Anything but, particularly McCartney. It was that run from Mull of Kintyre. I remember that because it didn't go away. You know, there was all this punk stuff happening, but it stayed at number one for so long. And at first you go, oh, look at this bagpipes. That's unusual. Bagpipes on this one. And then a week later and a week later and a month later and a month later, it was still, oh, there's the bagpipes again. So that was the sort of, you know, that. And I can remember, I'll give my regards to Broad Street coming out. And that just, you know, the critical hammering that sort of got. Oh. So it was, for Paul McCartney, it was a very harsh time. And I also remember when John Lennon died and all these songs went to number one, like Imagine went to number one. Mm-hmm. And I remember Woman going to number one. And I thought that, oh, that's an old song, right? Because it sounds like an old song. It doesn't sound like, you know, the modern day music. It sounds like an old song. That must be from the back. You know, when I realized later that, no, that was his posthumous new single, it was a bit of a shock. But it was really the Britpop era there, and the anthology that it all started to click into place, I think, for me.
Yeah, thankfully the 90s came back around and all the important British bands were all Beatles influenced, so that was the best thing that could ever have happened to them. Digression number one. Mm. So Lennon dies, Imagine goes to number one. Michael Jackson's death, Man in the Mirror was the number one here in the UK, if you remember.
Oh, okay.
What's going to be the song that goes to number one? I'm not ever going to say it, but you know.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. And
what song will they play when that happens?
It's part of me was about to say Live and Let Die, but that would probably be a bit tasteless. That'd be a little bit wrong on some level. It's got to be Let It Be, hasn't it?
Let It Be. Yeah, it's unfortunately not going to be a solo McCartney track, is it? It's going to be a Beatles song most likely. Probably. Maybe I'm Amazed, maybe.
I mean, I'd make a case for Silly Love Songs.
Ooh, because that's his life. That's
because that sort of sums him up, you know, so well.
But now, I want a B-side from Press to Play, straight to number one. Tough on a Tightrope, something like that. Hang Glide,
Okay, yeah, well... We'll see what the British streaming population have got to say about that. It'll be like when Bowie died, and it was just the amount of amazing stuff was just what was so shocking and so surprising. Mm. Obviously, we just had Black Star like the week, like the Friday before, and everyone was. I was listening to Black Star, and then it was just it's the quantity. And I think that is the most overwhelming thing with McCartney. He sort of slightly hid it. When you know, he could have done a Glastonbury set where it's like, here's this one you all know, and this one you all know, and this
his Glastonbury set was such a wonderful fuck you to normal people.
wasn't it?
Letting Let's go, Junior's Farms. Yeah, what Junior's are these?
Farm. Yeah. You know, the ones you like from Egypt Station. Well, here you go.
I had a guy who was telling me that this is actually a lost episode of the show. I didn't click record, just make sure I am now. Yes, I am indeed recording that. Mm-hmm. Apparently people were leaving at the back. People were leaving in droves. And it wasn't until he went, you know, well, she was just seven. Yeah. And then everyone starts, you know, flocking on back. But I was just sat at home absolutely, you know, clutching my belly with laughter. It was a wonderful set.
It was, because it was such a Paul McCartney thing to do.
Yeah.
It was totally he turned 80, right? Mm-hmm. He was on the Saturday night headline of the Pyramid Stage at Glastonbury. There's no more prestigious gig. There's no bigger audience. It was being streamed. I think it was paused, but it was being streamed to the country and everyone in the world would see it. And he could have just sort of said, well, look, this is the moment to sort of summarize my entire life's work and you know, and say, I did that, you know, look at my work, ye mighty in despair, that sort of thing. But just wanted to play Junior's Farm. And
well, I'm glad. Oh, but
I'm glad he didn't do what he did at the Jubilee, which was all of England's watching. What do we open with? This is the Magical Mystery Tour. Oh, God's sake. Even Beatle fans consider that like a lower mid-tier song call. Come on. All My Loving, you know?
Yeah, come out.
He'll never... There's never a bad McCartney gig where he starts with All My Loving. It's just the... trick the audience. Some quick-fire questions. Can I push you for a favourite Beatles era and album, song, or the generic?
Probably favourite album is the White Album.
Okay, strong choice.
In the sense of it being more than the sum of its parts.
Mm-hmm.
It's something unlike any other album with that record. If you took any part of... If you took even the bits you didn't like out of it, it would be less. Mm-hmm. It's odd. It's very, very... No one can agree what tracks it should have on it and things like that.
It was the Bloody Beatles White Album, shut up.
Yes. I should just put that on the front.
Honestly, we would buy it if they just repackaged it with that still on the front cover.
Yeah, absolutely we would. Era, I want to say that sort of... That mid-era. Mm-hmm. That sort of just ahead of Sergeant Pepper, so it's not
Help, Rubber Soul, like Revolver, yeah.
Exactly, yeah. Help, I'm a big supporter of. I really love Help. You can just sort of sense that something is afoot, something is happening. By that point, they'd got, you know, as big as any band could possibly ever dream of being. They'd achieved everything they ever wanted to do, 1965. In theory, there was nothing else left for them to do but maybe try and sustain for as long as they could before the inevitable sort of drop-off. And we know that that's not what happened. They just changed and then mutated. And you can start to see in that album, even in things like Yesterday, that there's higher peaks that they can sort of go for, and higher peaks. I mean, I love the song Help in particular, because I think that was I didn't have much luck in the inheriting records from older generations.
Oh, really?
Department. But my auntie had with the Beatles and the 7-inch of Help. And with the Beatles had this massive scratch down one side. had the 7-inch of Help and in mono, like that real glorious sort of mono punch. And it's so perfectly crafted, that song. You know, I it doesn't really get a lot of love, but I mean, I'm in awe of it. I mean, it's everything about it is just right. It's just so right and so perfect. And the way the backing vocals go ahead and then behind, and it's so intricate, and the just the simple emotion of it. I think it's just a phenomenal song, Help. And it's massively overlooked.
All I can think of now is that your next book needs to be called 7 Inches of Help. I think that's the ultimate title. Of course, do not let the fact that this is a primarily Paul McCartney-based podcast affect this next question, but favourite Beatle, come on.
I think that's a question that should never be asked, because it's the relationships between the four of them that is where the magic lies. That's the alchemy. I think if you viewed one of them as above or below the others, it breaks it. It's the four perfect parts. It's like, I think I describe it in the book as saying that like Ringo's earth, John is fire, George is water,
Paul is
air. And together that creates the fifth element. And having a favorite Beatle just seems not to understand that, I don't know. But it's the amount of people who've read the book and gone, Paul's your favourite, isn't he? It's quite high. Quite high.
That's so funny.
And I was a little bit surprised, because I'd put that chapter in about giving my regards to Broad Street, you know, which, you know, he may not have, you know, come out quite so well. But I think it's to do with the sense of Paul being reevaluated. It's quite well established in sort of Beatle fandom circles now.
Mm-hmm.
But just go slightly outside of that, there's still the notion that, oh, John was the great genius and like Paul was a bit wet, does sort of, in my generation, it sort of lingers for people of my age, not so much in the younger people who just think it's bizarre, but for Generation X like myself, that sort of lingers there. So Paul, for those people, came out of the book better than I think people were expecting. I think, I mean, to be honest, he comes out of it better than anyone, I think.
Well, the most famous reassessment in Beatledom is obviously that Revolver's now better than Sergeant Pepper. We've all put our stamp of approval. That is official dogma now.
That's the Gen X position. The baby boomers, Those who were there, it was Sergeant Pepper.
Yeah, yeah.
We came up and we go, no, mate, for God's sake, it's Revolver. Jesus, just listen to Tomorrow Never Knows. Millennials, they sort of go for Abbey Road.
Because it's the modern album. It's the one that most sounds like what they're listening to now.
Yeah.
Real G's like me, real cool kids. We're all about Rubber Soul. We're all about Rubber Soul. Yeah. Kids, don't do heroin, don't do LSD, but you can smoke and drink a lot. And that's summed up in Rubber Soul for me, you know. I don't want you smacked out on the floor, like in the late B session. Mm-hmm. I don't want you jumping off the roof, but you can giggle in the studio. I think that's what sums up Rubber Soul for me.
This is good advice. You'd make a good parent, clearly.
Yes. You know, look, I want to buy you your LSD because I don't want you buying it off some random bloke on the street. I want to know where your LSD is coming from. Now, you've covered history and culture in many forms across your career, and one of your earliest books was on Timothy Leary, aka the man who inspired the song Come Together. And so, look, just look me in the eye. You've definitely wanted to write a Beatles book for a while, right?
Yeah. I had no shame in it.
Yeah.
I wanted to write a Beatles book for a long time, but I didn't have the way to do it. I didn't have the sort of the angle that I thought would give people who knew the story completely sort of enough of an interesting sort of perspective to make it worth people's while. So, yeah. Timothy Leary really is quite a major lyricist for the Beatles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the way things like Imagine, the credits have been changed, so it's Lennon and Nono now, for perfectly valid and good reasons. You know, there's quite a few songs that should be like Lennon Leary or something like that. Or even All Things Must Pass is just a complete rip-off of Leary's rewriting of the Data Jing. So George Harrison was taking from him as well. So there's at least three songs from them four.
I mean, the most complicated one would probably be Eleanor Rigby, because that was like written in an SNL style, you do a line, I'll do a line. Because there was like, I think Ringo did Darning His Socks, George did Look at All the Lonely People. And there was, it's not Stu Sutcliffe, but it's one of the periphery figures of a Stu Sutcliffe level in 66 or threw in a line as well.
It was John's mate, Pete Shotton, wasn't it?
Pete Shotton, yeah.
He chucked in a line, yeah. Didn't he suggest me bringing the two verses together in the last boss? It was something like that.
The most genius part of the song, yeah. yeah. Just a little thing. I mean, it all goes back. Like, songwriting was fully explained to me again in that George Harrison documentary, Living in the Material World. It's just when Paul goes, no, so we just wrote the chords, but George wrote, do-do-do-do, and like, that's the song. And I'm like, oh, yeah, that's how it works. So you get the songwriting credit, right? I'll get yours too one day, Paul. I'll get yours, you know.
Yeah, and that very first thing they recorded, they gave George a credit because he came up with the solo.
Cry for a Shadow.
No, it wasn't Cry for a Shadow.
The B side of that will be in the day, which is
That thing. Which will come back to us in a second. He did it live. They cut it out at Glastonbury.
Okay, folks. This man looks up something on computer.
There's no point. Or every listener has turned off.
In spite of all the danger.
In spite of all the danger. I'm sure.
It says here credited to the Quarrymen specifically. So that's why George has the credit. I mean, yeah, I was going to say, I don't think it was an early song.
I can't remember which one it was, but anyway.
I thought Lennon and George wrote Cry for a Shadow. I thought that was the early instrumental or something like that. I think George should have got a writing credit for She Said, She Said as well. I think he helped John write that one as well.
Yeah,
it gets very complicated. I mean, let's not even go into Lennon McCartney, McCartney Lennon for certain songs as well.
Let's not go get into that.
No good's
going to come from getting to that.
It's a whole episode. It's going to be dull to do, but it'll be very interesting to listen to. Let's
Lennon McCartney just sounds better, Paul. It just sounds better.
It does. It's why the phrase Bond, James Bond sounds way better than Muddave's James Bond, you know. But Brummy Bond, now that'd be great. But yeah,
maybe next time. Who knows? They're taking a very long time to sort of come up with the next James Bond. You know, I mean.
Yeah, actually, let's get into it. This is the topical yin to the Beatles yang. How long normally is there between announcing a new Bond and getting rid of the old one? Like, because I was there for James Bond. I was there for the controversial headlines when Craig came into the role, but I don't remember the gap between that and Die Another Day.
Yeah, when you said James Bond, I just assumed you were thinking about the 1960s Beatle cartoon with the character James Bond in it. But yes, you're talking about Daniel Craig. I mean, if you look, say, in the 80s, they were turning films out one every 2 years. So you'd get A View to a Kill, Roger Moore would leave, they'd get Roger Dolan, the next one 2 years later. There was not even a pause for this sort of change. There was a big gap for legal reasons between Dalton and Pierce Brosnan. It was like 5 years or something like that.
Was that all part of the Blofeld rights and Smersh and stuff like that as well?
I don't think that one was, but all that was been going on in the background during the Daniel Craig era.
Well, because that whole legal trouble fucked up the quintology, because it was clearly not ever going to be Spectre in the first two movies.
Yeah.
And then it's a bit like when in those Avengers films, when they didn't know they were going to have Spider-Man until Sony said, yes, it's okay. And it's like, oh shit, okay, right, we need a 30-minute scene with Spider-Man now. Yeah. And it's because, you know, it's not about stories, it's about what people recognize. If people see that octopus, granddad will go to the cinema.
Yeah, absolutely.
I've just thought of a fantastic question, and I'm going to write it down while I ask you this next one.
Okay.
Please tell me about your first encounter with Mr. James Bond, 007.
Again, it's, you know, I'm of the generation where it was always around. It was, you know, it would be on the TV every bank holiday, and your families would watch it, and that's all gone now. You know, kids aren't watching James Bond films with their dad on a bank holiday anymore. They're not in the same room. They've got their own sort of screens. But I saw A View to a Kill at the cinema. And, you know, it had Duran Duran doing the music. So you're like, ooh, this is special, you know.
Modern.
that's my main memory. But again, being of the generation I am, it was really the GoldenEye video game that sort of made the whole thing relevant.
Okay. Now we're getting into it.
Yeah.
Here's my controversial take.
Yes.
The Pierce Brosnan movies have the best songs of any Bond era, cumulatively. The Madonna one is the single most underrated.
Okay.
People hate that song, man. People fucking hate that song. It's so good.
Yeah.
So good.
I mean, it's such a great title sequence as well, because they've got the whole little plot about him being sort of captured in and tortured.
Yeah, the diamonds in his face.
Sort of going on. So there's all that sort of stuff going on. So, yeah. It's not like Sam Smith, where you're just like, oh, God, has it finished yet?
He was dressed as a Bond villain the other night. That Now, that joke will date this episode very specifically to the 2023 Awards era.
Probably not with Sam Smith.
Yeah.
You know, any particular point in the future, it's probably going to work great.
No, I mean, the funny thing with Sam Smith is I don't dislike him because of his sexuality or his weight, which are the two things that are always in the media. I dislike him because I think his music's quite rubbish. And unfortunately, all the other people who dislike him are lumped in my camp. And I'm like, well, I'd rather not say anything about it. Like, the writings on the wall. It's like that. Spectre was already off to a bad start, right? It is a very poorly put together bunch of scenes that happen. There's no story.
Yeah, I mean,
the second half of No Time to Die suffers from the exact same thing. The first half of No Time to Die could be some of the best Bond ever, particularly the first half hour.
Sure.
But all the modern ones, they just start tapering off. Like, I was like, No Time to Die, this is really cool. Nanobots? Oh, come on.
But it did give us the phrase Blofeld's bionic eye. And for that, we'll be eternally grateful. I think I'm more of a supporter of the last one, No Time to Die.
When he strangles him, when he gets him and goes, die, Blofeld, die, I'm like, this is awesome. This is like Casino Royale pre-titles credit sequence.
Yeah,
And
Blofeld in his little box in like an Amazon warehouse being wheeled out to be strangled.
He looked like that commander in Star Trek that had been paralyzed and had to sit, talk through that, that beeping wheelchair. All of you listening to this probably like Star Trek. You're of that age. Just let me know in the comments down below what I'm referring to.
It was just that weird thing, though. They'd done this huge, oh, we've got Spectre back, we've got Blofeld back.
And we've got Christoph Waltz to play him as well.
Yeah. So, great, what should we do with him? Oh, well, we'll just kill him off and have another villain. It's like, oh, for God's sake.
No, not just kill him off. Kill them all off.
Call them all off.
At the same party.
Yeah.
At the same... I mean, imagine if the American government could have done that with, like a terrorist cell. There'd be no news ever. Yes, so there was a large cadre of insurgents, and we threw them a party, and they all died. It's so lazy.
You need to design nanobots that kill people who deserve it.
Yeah.
If you can work out how to do that, then...
And you know what? That I'm going to end up spoiling future questions. I've got a rigorous order set up here,
John. Oh, okay.
I really do. You actually mentioned in Chapter 9 that Bond is most commonly watched between father and sons. And I'm not going to lie, that is exactly my experience with it. My dad loved Rog the Dodge, as he always used to refer to him. I guess Roger Moore's Bond has, even probably more so than Lazenby, who is basically Austin Powers at this point, hasn't aged particularly well to the modern era, has it? I mean,
no. And it's almost part of its charm.
It's so
Roger Moore, and if someone's being themselves to that extent, you just have to go. You just have to go with it. It's quite. There's a lot of chauvinism in the 70s stuff. Mm. You know, you can see the in the 60s it was issues of consent that were the real problem. It's like, oh, Roger, she's saying no for God's sake. No, sorry, Sean. Mm. Oh, Sean, she said no. You know,
oh, Sean, don't hit her.
That does go. And in the 70s, this real chauvinism comes. It's all, ooh, women drivers and things like that. It's like, oh, for God's sake. You see all these sort of things change. But the overall sort of thing, there's a sense that it would be fun to be Roger Moore. Like, there's a sense that he knows that his world is absurd, right? And he quite likes it. And he quite enjoys the ridiculousness of his entire existence. And there's something very sort of appealing about that.
Because if the Moore films were released in the modern context and, you know, make all the necessary changes in this alternative universe to make that make sense. Mm. But if it was released in a modern critical realm, let's say, those films would be accused of directly trying to antagonize the audience into how ridiculous they can be, you know what I mean? Like, he jumps the shark several times and then sticks the landing. You're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to jump the shark and then crash into its open jaws, you know?
Yeah. It's the odd thing about the Bond films is they are weirdly self-mocking. They do know that they're Bond films. And they do let the audience in on the joke, as it were. They take themselves very seriously. Except when they don't. And sometimes it goes too far, like in Moonrakers, the pigeon does a double take when Roger Moore drives his gondola through Venice.
When he's a clown or...
Yeah, no, I quite liked him when he was a clown. That was quite weirdly surreal. Sometimes there's a sort of a strange House of Mirrors nightmarish quality that's realness in Bond films.
Whatever happened to Roger Moore in the black turtleneck with a giant Harry, Dirty Harry revolver? That was in Live and Let Die for about 2 minutes, and then you never see it again. I was like, oh no, that'd be really cool. And it is the poster, weirdly.
Yeah. I thought you were about to say with a giant Haribo for some reason. Massive sweeties.
There'd be some pun about confectionery. No, you do mention that. In the book that Bond, and I guess the same could be said for the Beatles as well, that they don't take themselves too seriously, but they also take themselves very seriously. Mm. Is that an inherently British quirk, and is that required for a lasting pop culture dynasty?
I think it is. That's not to say it's exclusively British, but I do think it's hard to think of something that feels... Oh, and things lack that, like, I don't know, like The Crown or Downton Abbey.
I was going to say.
British culture, there's this like establishment layer on the top, this crust, as you probably want to call it, that for the vast majority of the people in this country, it's totally alien and we don't understand it and we should it all go away. But that seems to be the stuff that sells well in America or is promoted abroad or, you know, the public schools of Harry Potter and all that sort of stuff. Yeah. That tends to lack the self-awareness that everything else has. And it can't have the self-awareness because if it did, its entire, you know, reason to be would just sort of collapse. It would just go up in a puff of logic, you know. Mm-hmm. So it can't have that level of self-awareness. And, you know, that exists. But really what's interesting is everything else, everything mm-hmm. sort of going on. And that is very, very common just to... It's to do with, I think, you sort of need to remain on the level of your audience and you can't elevate yourself to the big I am without splitting that relationship. You know, the moment you think you're a superior sort of being, your relationship with the audience is just, it's not a proper connection. So it's necessary, it's really needed for musicians and writers and authors and stuff like that to recognize that they aren't more special than the audience, that they are sort of talking to equals. And in that way, it can be really funny, I think.
It almost puts them both up to the position of an establishment within the society. Like, you've got the Royal Family, mocked incessantly, but also they are to be respected fully. Same with the police, the army, doctors, teachers. It really does push them beyond something just like, oh, these are just films, this is just music. And you do talk about a lot in the introduction that this is far more than just these individual topics at hand. Actually, you know what, I'm getting a bit ahead of myself here, and forgive me for the most basic of bog standard questions here.
Yeah,
but let's get into the book.
Okay,
what is Love and Let Die about?
Well, it is. I knew there was something. The gist of it.
This question, because it is so complicated to actually. It's a difficult elevator pitch, I feel, if you know what I mean. I feel like.
No, it's the simplest. It's basically Bond and the Beatles are twins. They were born on the same day. The first Beatles single and the first James Bond film came out on the 5th of October, 1962. And they both became these huge sort of cultural monsters that have very different views on what it means to be British. So it's looking at their story because there's something weirdly... both are utterly implausible, right? Neither of them make any sense. You know, the idea that, you know, you could create an action hero and make a film of an action hero and then go on to make, you know, 26 sequels over like 60 years, all of which are successful, all of which you make money. Utterly impossible. There's no way that could happen. Every film producer would do that if there was any way that it was possible to do. And if it wasn't for the fact that James Bond exists, you know, the whole idea would be absurd. And in a similar way, there's no way a band could do what the Beatles did, you know, in terms of their impact, their cultural and musical sort of, you know, the idea that four lads could get together and hope to have the level of impact that the Beatles did. Again, it's just impossible. It's not going to happen. So neither of them makes sense, but we don't notice because they're so familiar. They're so much part of our lives and always have been, and they've always been there, and we think we know them. So we rarely look at them and go, Jesus Christ, did that really happen? That's insane. That's just mad. And for those reasons, it sort of makes sense to talk about them together because they don't really fit with their peers. You know, Bond and other action movies, they're different things. And the Beatles, even, you know, when you get... 60s nights or something like that, they probably won't include the Beatles because there's a sort of understanding that it's something different to the 60s music. You know, we're long past the point where people would, you know, talk about the Stones and the Beatles as being in some way equivalent. Well, yeah, you know.
That was a very good passage in the book. Yeah, it was like, this guy knows.
It was the case. It used to be the Beatles and the Stones, and that was, but now it's people talk about the Beatles and Shakespeare, you know. No shame on the Stones. great at being the Rolling Stones, don't get me wrong, but the Beatles, the further we get away from them, the more perspective we get on them, just the bigger they become. And as I say in the book, the only thing that ever becomes bigger than the Beatles is the Beatles.
Now, the reason I ask you that specific question is because I don't want people to get confused and just to think that in this book, Love and Let Die, that it's just you going through the Beatles story separately and the Bond story separately with a couple of random connections. And we'll go through some of the obvious ones later. But I just like that this was essentially a histography of culture seen through the lens of the Beatles and Bond. And, you know, you've been doing this as a history and culture writer for a while, pop culture writer. What can the study of pop culture and culture tell us about a society that the study of kings and queens and wars and economics can't tell us?
Yeah, absolutely. It's, you know, if you go to the history section of Waterstones, and if you look at all the books, they're essentially stories of power. They're all about, you know, power, be that, you know, military power, you know, economic power, like the East India Company, symbolic power, like the monarchy. All our history books, we tell our story, our history, through an account of power. There are other ways, and one is the imagination. One is, you know, our inner selves. They can reveal so much more about the changes that happen to our society than just looking at power. And if you read all those books, there's a sense that, oh, well, what's a film? You know, what's a song? What's that sort of got to do with how we became who we are? They seem ephemeral. They seem really unimportant. But I see imagination and power is like fire and water. You know, they are very different. They act on us very different. And yet, you know, a forest fire is going to have as much impact as a tsunami. They are both phenomenally powerful. And the way that music, particularly music in this case, has changed us, the way that people in the 1970s were so different to people in the 1950s, largely, not entirely, but largely through those cultural changes that were spearheaded by the Beatles, you know, is deep and profound. And if you only look at the story of power, you aren't really understanding what it's like to be alive and like what it's like to be human. You know, our music, our art, our films, they're reflections of our inner selves. You know, that's what art is. It's a mirror to the soul. And that when that changes, we change. And if there's a change in our culture, there's a change in our art, that means there's a change in what it's like to live in society at that point, and it's just reflecting that. So you need them both. You have to have them both. So, yeah, I'm all for writing books that focus on the immaterial as much as the mighty, I guess.
If you want to just look at it on a more basic, bog-standard graph as well, I mean, how many people know trivia about the Beatles and about Bond, but who knows what the Queen's sister's maiden name is? You know what I mean? Who knows where all of the stately homes are? Do you know where Isham is? I don't, you know.
No, exactly. But those will be the things that history departments will be sort of fully aware of. You know, they will know where Isham is and things like that, as if, you know, all this matters, you know, honestly.
No, but I don't feel like in 10 years when Netflix is finished with The Crown and does my scripted Beatles show, which is 10 seasons long, a season, an album, various cameo roles throughout the show to boost my own profile, blah, blah, blah. But, is Netflix going to have an article where Judi Dench goes, you know, you shouldn't watch the new Beatles show. It's not very respectful to what happened with Paul McCartney in the 60s.
The Crown will never mention anything in British history in which working class people do anything extraordinary. So if you're watching, say, the 1960s, you know, came through.
All the common people have to do is be crushed by coal mining shafts.
Yes, absolutely.
That's literally it.
They made Aberman about the Queen's emotions. Oh, my. The Beatles, no mention at all. England won the World Cup, no mention at all. It's just anything that doesn't, you know, glorify the monarchy, It doesn't exist in that sort of story.
There's just a whole bottle episode where Charles just listens to Revolver.
I think this is bloody good, you know. I think Tiggy would love this one.
Yeah, there was that. There was one time in Goldfinger where Bond, our establishment killer, dissed the Beatles. It's quite a famous line.
Without earmuffs or something.
That's the line.
You know what, folks? We'll play the clip right.
Who needs it?
My dear girl, there are some things that just aren't done, such as drinking Dom Perignon 53 above a temperature of 38 degrees Fahrenheit. That's as bad as listening to the Beatles without earmuffs.
And it's such a moment that clangs, because, you know, the whole point about Bond is he's supposed to know what quality is. You know, he's supposed to know what's good. He knows all the right suits, the right cars, the right food, the right drink. When he gets it wrong,
no,
exactly. When he gets it wrong, it's a bit of a shock. And you'll notice that at no point in any Bond film after that moment does he make any comment about culture ever again. You know, he never goes, you know, oh, here's what I think about Beyonce's last album. You know? And it would be weird if he did. It would be really wrong. He doesn't exist on that plane.
Well, no, because, well, at the rate these people get cancelled as well. Like, imagine if in Quantum of Solace, he was like, I like Kanye West, I like Prince Andrew, and I like J.K. Rowling. You know, it's like, oh, James, no, no, bro, no.
No, but in Quantum of Solace, we had Strawberry Field, of course.
Agent, you know what? I think I've got a list of silly little connections. Yeah, Bond mocks in Beatles and Goldfinger. My dear girl, there are some things that just aren't done, such as drinking Dom Perignon 53 above the temperature of 38 degrees Fahrenheit. That's as bad as listening to the Beatles without earmuffs. We've got Agent Strawberry Fields, played by the woefully underutilized Gemma Arterton.
True, yes.
But I love Gemma's arse a ton. That was my joke at school. Ringo marries Barbara Bach, a Bond girl, of course. Paul writes Live and Let Die. One of the Bond girls in A Hard Day's Night is in a Bond. I think she's in Dr. No, as well as the guy who plays M is also in A Hard Day's Night as well.
Oh, so yes, you're thinking of Margaret Nolan.
Yes,
she's in the film as Masseuse, but she's also the woman painted gold on the poster of Goldfinger.
And finally, Help is also one big Bond spoof in itself, which is
absolutely.
That's snake or a Boros eating itself. You know what I mean?
And I love that McCartney got an Aston Martin DB5.
Yes,
and a DB6, but that period where he had a bit of time off, so he goes, "What shall I do? I'll get a disguise and I'll drive around France in an Aston Martin." To be the most Bond-like sort of character that he could be, and that led to the idea of maybe the Beatles could be in disguise, maybe Beatles could become Sergeant Peppers. And I love the fact that the gadgets he had in that car include a record player.
Well, do you remember McCartney's car in Give My Regards to Broad Street, which is a Bond car? It's got his schedule and it talks to him. It's pre-Knight Rider. I might be wrong there. I think it might be pre-Knight
Rider. It is, because I'm trying to remember. I don't wish to give any spoilers to people who have yet to see Give My Regards to Bond Street, but it's Broad Street.
Or Knight Rider.
or Knight Rider. But the car changes when he's in a dream or not, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So most of the film, it's this weird dream sort of version of his car.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the one that
I know. We ain't going to be in London till Monday.
So he was in this Aston Martin when he was driving to see Cynthia Lennon after John had dumped her. And that's when he started writing Hey Jude in this Bond car. So the amount of crossover and all things like that and connections are just... I mean, because they've both got such huge cultural footprints, they're obviously going to sort of tread on each other all the time. So you can have a bit of fun with that.
Let's talk about writing the book, because this is the stuff that I'm particularly interested in as a man who has perennially always felt like he's had a book in him.
Now, what stopped it? What stopped it coming out, Sam?
Oh, I mean, because then I'd have to just stop being a lazy asshole. You know what I mean? And that is a particular hill that all men must cross at some point, and with England and everyone else in between.
But I feel for you.
Because it's like, you know, friends, family, work, podcast, time off, exercise, good diet, yeah. And it's like something's got to give. Sleep. I might get really fat and write a book. I think that's the only option I've got. and I'm talking Brendan Fraser in The Whale, which actually is the worst movie I've seen all year. But it's only just the start of 2023, so there's plenty of time for that to change.
Okay, I hadn't seen it, but I'd heard the opposite. So
great performances, terrible story, terrible writing. Although he does have the best scene of a man eating pizza ever.
Okay. I don't have to go to the cinema to see that, though.
No.
I could just angle the mirror.
So I was there with my mates. There was about four of us. And I went, can we go? And my friend turned to me and went, if one of us wants to stay, we all stay. And the guy on the end, Danny, you bastard, he really wanted to see the end. And when I went to the toilet halfway through, I went to the concession stand and they went, how long's left of The Whale? 5:30 start? And she went, about 12 minutes. And I was like, oh, thank God. Oh, thank God. Okay, I'll sit through this tripe. Yeah. But yeah, talk about the book. You've got Beatles, you've got Bond. You've got the connective tissue of Britain pop culture and the zeitgeist psyche of everyone who lives in this country.
Yeah.
How do you go about, we're going to get to the structure, which might be the answer, I don't know, very shortly, but do you just start writing a bunch of Beatles stuff? Do you then start writing a bunch of Bond stuff? Do you then try and work them together? Was there a version of this book where you weren't following the structure, where it was just pages of information, you know?
No, it's the simple act of putting the two things next to each other sort of dictated what it was, because we think we know the Beatles and we think we know Bond and they're so familiar to us, and we, you know, it's only when you put them next to each other that it's suddenly all these different angles on them are revealed, and all this stuff about masculinity and, you know, class and Britain over those years, all this sort of starts pouring out of them, and you just go, oh, I hadn't noticed all these sort of these aspects of them before. Then it's just a case of getting all that down and just, yeah, put it in chronological order, because that sort of worked. But it was I'd written a book about William Blake before called William Blake Versus the World. And in Blake's mind, opposites, contraries, as he calls it, are the thing that defines us. So whereas a lot of religious writers would go, oh, well, hell's bad, but like heaven, that's great. So let's write a load of stuff about heaven. We're really into heaven. To Blake, that was just insane, because you couldn't have hell without heaven. So he wrote The Marriage of Heaven and Hell. He kept them together. And it was the energy and dynamism between these two poles that was what mattered, and that was what was interesting. And so I thought, oh, that's an interesting way. I wonder if it would work. You know, I wonder if you could just get two seemingly opposed subjects and put them next to each other, and they would just, between them, they'd just sort of crackle, and it would be full of insight and interest. And so that's, once I'd spotted that they were both twins and born on the same day, all that sort of seemed to fall into place. And so in theory, it's just a chronological tale where you hop between them, the two. Well, at least I thought it would be. But the amount of chapters that I would start thinking this is a Beatles chapter, and you go, no, actually it's not. It's as equal, as much a Bond chapter as it is a Beatles chapter. Yeah.
Let me just interrupt you there. So folks, for anyone who hasn't read the book yet, which I certainly recommend you do, most of the chapters will either follow, well, it's John picks a year. So we start off in 1945 with the backdrop of Ringo in post-war England. And then that goes all the way up right to the modern day. So the way I've shown it here, I've got the first 10 chapters, Beatles 45, Bond 52, Beatles 56. Then we have a joint chapter in 1960. And this was the one that I thought was really interesting. Because it's like, oh, this is where this motherfucker's starting to tie these themes together. I see what he's doing here.
Yeah.
Sex. Bond, sex figure. Beatles are having their sex lives in Fleming's sex life. It was all brought together beautifully, boss. It really was. This was absolutely fantastic, Ryan. You brought it all together. Only chapter four! And then, you know, we've got to go through, and then it's Bond 61, Beatles 62.
Yeah.
We have a joint chapter in chapter nine, which is the mania of both groups. I thought
that Bond mania and Beatlemania, yeah. the thing about the sex chapter that just was, there were so many moments like this where when I discovered that literally 2 weeks before the Beatles went to Hamburg,
Ian Fleming reviewed the sex clubs,
wrote in the Sunday Times basically a sex tourism article about the Hamburg sex clubs, and it's just like,
oh. It's like, dude, I mean, like, there was a part of me thinking, this guy, he's just written this book because of the 1962 date. There's not going to be many more connections. He's tugging at. When I saw that, I was like, bloody hell, there is a lot. There's a lot going on here. Oh my gosh. But I love that chapter. And then chapter nine as well. And that introduces the topic of crisis in masculinity and like how Bond and the Beatles, these two diametrically opposed views of masculinity.
Mm.
And you do that basically throughout the book. You lull us into this sense of security with Bond, Beatles. And then it's like, and it's almost like a plenary chapter. Every three chapters, like, this is what you've learned, and this is how you're now going to apply it in the real world. See you on Monday. And I really enjoyed that writing style. And the structure features a lot of short chapters.
Mm,
is this naturally your writing style, or did you want to create a fast reading experience?
It's books sort of suggest what their structure should be. Most books I write tend to have quite long chapters.
Mm-hmm.
This one wanted to be fast and pacey. And to be honest, this book just wanted to be bigger and bigger and bigger. I always had this notion that...
It's beefy.
Yeah, it's 140,000 words. I always had this rule that, you know, you shouldn't go over 100,000 words because that's, like, just rude, right? Because people... They've got a lot on, you know. If you can't say what you want to say in 100,000 words, you're really not trying hard enough. I always struggle to sort of make them punchy and sharp and stuff like that. I hadn't sort of reckoned with the fact that the Beatles are infinite and you can never say everything.
Have you seen how big TuneIn is? You're referencing enough in this.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, my God.
Absolutely, I do, yeah. By the way,
just as an aside, it's nice to see someone basically... bow down to TuneIn in the middle of their own book. It was very humble.
What's it?
Because like so many other Beatle books you read, they try and go, no, you can read TuneIn, but this one, it's like, yours was like, this is a very interesting work. It's a very specific chat, you know, part of pop culture. But I like the way you tipped your hat. If you want to know everything about everything and lose your mind.
Yeah,
and go Mark Lewis is
the guy. Absolutely, because... What Mark Lewison's done, not just him, but, you know, primarily him, is he's nailed down exactly what happened to a degree that I don't think any cultural phenomenon has had before. I think we know more about the Beatles than anything in history. And that sounds, I'm just making that off the top of my head. I've thought a lot about that. It's that point when we had cameras and we had newspapers following them every day, every single day. What they did was recording. And a proper historian like Mark Lewison has really nailed down exactly what happened. So even there's still things like Get Back where we go, oh, we didn't quite have it right, you know. We sort of know to a really good degree what happened. But that means we can start writing, you know, about the more interesting question of, well, what does it mean?
Mm-hmm.
You know, which is still quite unexplored territory. And I think there'll be a lot of it. And I think there'll be a lot more books by female writers coming up. And I'm really interested to see where the next sort of phase of Beatles books takes us.
I mean, the two most fascinating things I've read that the Beatles themselves have released. Questlove did the introduction for the Revolver box set book. Hanif Qureshi, who you reference in this book, he did the foreword for the non-vinyl box set Get Back Peter Jackson coffee table book.
Yes.
And it was like, oh my God, reading the Beatles from a perspective that's not a 45-year-old white man from Clapham, this is actually very interesting.
It is.
And it's insane how just... tweaking the person telling the same story completely recontextualizes it, and you know, everything's changed. I can only imagine Mark Lewison is so happy that Eyes of the Storm is coming out before he releases part two as well.
Yeah, absolutely. What was I going to say? There is something mythic about their story. I mean, it's you'd think after a point, I've read enough Beatles books now. I get it. I know what happens. I'll move on to something else. I'm going to get bored of this. It never happens. The more you read about them, the more interesting they become. And just the relationship between those four men. It's not a normal level of story. It is myth. It is endless. It is something you just constantly go back to and inform by. It's, you know, you don't get that with, I don't know, Culture Club or you two or something. There's something about their story that is out of all the band stories, out of all the music or sort of histories, there's something about theirs that it's just bottomless. And
it's probably easier to think of the facet of British life that they didn't impact.
Yes.
Like shipping trading routes were not affected by the Beatles. That's
well,
a book.
You say that, but...
Yeah, we had to open an extra lane in the Liverpool Docklands to get the vinyl in, you know? Yeah. Everything changes.
It is the relationship between those four and, you know, how everything that happened, you look at, you know, what that tells us about George or what that tells us about what Ringo was thinking or something like that. Mm. Endlessly fascinating, it really is.
I mean, it's also the four archetypes as well. I mean, everyone projects themselves onto at least one Beatle, at least per story. Like, if I was John in that situation, I would have said this. I mean, it's the greatest what-if story ever. It's very... It's an idealized version of the Nirvana narrative, like taking yourselves out at the peak of your success. But Nirvana didn't come out just when television was entering everyone's homes. Nirvana didn't come out when women were sexually liberated, when masculinity was changed entirely, just after a giant world war.
Yeah.
Film still in its relevant infancy.
Yeah, the arrival of LSD.
Yeah. I mean... It borderline risks on the ultimate reductive narrative of they were in the right place at the right time.
It's absolutely true, but that's normal for all stories. You know, if you look at history,
Shakespeare,
things were right for this to happen at that point. You do get some historians from a very public school Oxbridge background who do stick to this, though. They go, oh, well, if it wasn't... they were just in the right time, the right place at the right time. If it hadn't been them, it would have been another band. It would be like, you know, Jerry and the Pacemakers.
And you were going to say Jerry and the Pacemakers.
Would be the 60s band. Yeah. And it's not because they never say, oh, well, you know, if Churchill hadn't turned up, you know, there would have been someone else who would have been the Churchill. They never do that. They have this real sort of issue with acknowledging that there's something unique about the Beatles.
Historians seem almost upset that the defining pop culture event of the 60s wasn't a battle that killed 400,000 working class people, you know? You know what I mean? So I imagine the hardest part about your chapters, being that they are so short, must be the idea of killing one's darlings. Was it hard to ensure that everything was brisk as it was?
That's what editing is for, really.
Is there stuff on the cutting room floor then, to say the least?
There's a lot of crap on the cutting room floor.
I love it.
You wouldn't want to go through it. I haven't gone through it myself. I've saved you. You know, I have saved you. You know, that's
So do you pull whole topics, or is there a game of how few words can I talk about this particular topic?
You write it and then you go over it and you write it better, and then you write it pacier and you sharpen and you get it as good as you can. But still, I mean, there's a Brian Epstein chapter that should be in there that just never quite got where it needed to
be. Well, okay, you know what? I'm going to counter that, because what I liked as... I don't know Bond in that much detail. I've seen most of the movies. I love most of the movies.
Yeah. You've grown up in this country, so therefore...
No, like, I'm always shocked when people say... Well, sorry, I'm never shocked when people say I haven't seen Star Wars or Harry Potter. You know, fine. But if you haven't heard the Beatles or seen a whole Bond movie, that's when you start to think you're from Planet Zog.
Yeah.
But what I liked about your writing Star Wars, it was very like... Keep up, kids, because I'm not going to spoon feed you this. And as a Beatle aficionado, someone who knows the story inside and out, I kind of liked the almost just a hand wave to sometimes like, and now they're with Brian Epstein. We don't need a whole. You probably know the story, person reading this, because you probably read the generic Beatle book and the generic Bond book. So I liked how you didn't hold our hands with everything. Like,
yeah.
You know, it was more like if you held our hand through a moment, it was probably because of some emotional impact. Like, we need to know who Aunt Mimi was, because that's how you know who John is. But you don't need to know about Brian Epstein and wanted to impress his dad and the shop. And all you need to know is he smelt a smelly, sweaty room and saw the four lads. And now the story's moving on. So, yeah, I really did enjoy that. And something else I really enjoyed about the book was the digressional moments throughout.
Well, that's can't help myself. You should see my other books, dear God.
No, my best friend Tom's read both of your William Blake books, and he said the same thing. Also, a William Blake quote starts the book as well, which I feel like it's just you being meta towards yourself more than anything.
Well, I am trying to normalize mentioning William Blake. I think it would be a far better, you know, society if people, because there's a lot of people, there's a lot of references in Blake that people don't, that aren't used, but universally known. We know the Greek mythology, but we don't know Blake's mythology. We're not taught it at school. You can't make a reference to Urizen and expect people to know what you mean and things like that. So just trying to sort of normalize that.
The only William Blake reference I could ever pull out of my hat is Red Dragon. That's about it. And that's because it's a sequel to one of the most iconic Oscar-winning films of all time. So it really doesn't count.
Yeah. Was it a prequel? I can't remember. It is a prequel.
Because they did Hannibal straight after, they did Hannibal a few years after with Julianne Moore. Everyone hated it. And within a year of the premiere, they'd already shot and edited Red Dragon. And it's directed by Brett Ratner, who's now been cancelled, who's one of the Me Too people, a real scumbag.
Oh, okay.
And everything he did after that was absolute garbage, like X-Men 3, horrible bosses. And yet Red Dragon's this like almost perfect sequel to or prequel to Silence of the Lambs. It's like, you know, Paul McCartney releasing Ram and then releasing Give My Regards to Broad Street. It's like, how does this work? You know what? Let's just talk about your little digressions, though, because the two that I particularly loved was Leslie Woodhead, who was the guy who filmed the first Cavern gig with you know, that clip of some other guy that we all know, and then the bricklayer's mate and the daughter of the brigadier. You just have a page on both these people. It's like, right, you can hear the record scratch almost like. Right.
Yeah.
By the way,
love it. Leslie Woodhead was the guy who shot that famous footage of the band at the Cavern before they were even signed, just a few days after after Ringo had joined the band. So it's like, historically, it's a gold dust.
We want Ringo. First,
we want Pete. It's the beginning of that period where the world turned their eyes and filmed them, recorded them and everything. That's the thing that started off. And the fact that he was a spy, and the fact that he spoke Russian. Did he speak Russian? He listened into Russian communications.
It does not help paranoid schizophrenics telling them this, by the way, because now Beatles were a government psyop. You know, they killed Kennedy and then brought in the Beatles.
Yeah.
Man, you know.
Yeah.
It definitely feels like that.
I mean, it was just so perfect for my, I wouldn't even call it a digression. It was absolutely crucial. The fact that he was so shaken by the Beatles and his understanding that something enormous was coming, that when he was driving back to Manchester after he had to sort of stop the car and be sick in a ditch.
Yeah.
You know, that's plot, mate. That's not something that's exactly where it's going. Yeah. The others was on the day of 5th of October 1962, the day of the first of Love Me Do and Dr. No coming out. That was the headlines in the newspapers. And it was one of those stories that just seems absurd now, because it required a respect for the upper classes that did not exist after the Beatles. And the story was that a bricklayer's mate had got engaged to a brigadier's daughter. And that made front page news, because it was so appalling to newspaper.
It's almost like the last.
This had happened. Yeah.
That's the last hurrah, the agonal death groans of the colonial British Empire. That
it sort of needed that to show where we'd come from, you know, because where we'd come from now looks so mad and so absurd that it's even. We blank it from our minds. It's easy to forget about that sort of stuff. But no, that's what the country was like when the Beatles arrived. You know? And so, hence, you can see how different it is after they've left.
I guess a lot of your digressions then are text and not subtext, then would be the best way to put it.
I dare say there's a few digressions in there for when there's a funny tale to be told.
Well, there's also.
I mean, I got away with a whole chapter on Christopher Lee.
Yes, I haven't got to that one, but I saw the title and I was like, what the fuck is this
about? Well, Christopher Lee was a Bond villain at the same time.
Golden Gun, yeah.
Yeah, at the same time he was on the cover of Band on the Run. So he crosses over between the two.
Christopher.
But in many ways, it was an excuse just to put a chapter about Christopher Lee in, because any book would be massively improved by that.
Well, Christopher Lee was in Lord of the Rings. The Beatles were going to be in a Lord of the Rings one. You know, you can
Peter Jackson. Yeah. Many a crossover.
Oh, we still need to. He dropped a hint that he was doing something Beatles related about 3 or 4 months ago. Come on, Peter.
I mean, I'm just hoping he's got all the rushes for Magical Mystery Tour, because they filmed a lot.
Didn't even consider that. There's so much stuff that they filmed. Oh, fucking hell. Oh, my God.
It might just be he's demixing, you know, the first few albums or some technical sort of thing like that. That's possible. But I imagine
to be something that, like, makes Lewison have to re-release the first book again. Like, oh, by the way, there was a camera crew for the entirety of the Please, Please Me album. Like, what? You know?
Don't. Because he would. So, you know, he's tempted to. You can just tell. You know, he's got loads of stuff to put in there now that wasn't in there. Just let him get on with it. Let him finish the.
I love any author that writes a book about an artist still releasing records. It's like, what's the fucking point? Why are you doing it? Because Luca Perazzi, an author who I admire greatly, his book, Paul McCartney, The Recording Sessions, basically built this podcast from the ground up in its earliest days.
Uh-huh.
And then Egypt Station, McCartney 2, McCartney 3 come out. It's like, luckily he's releasing a new book now. But there's always that void, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I do wonder if Mark Lewison, when he went to the publishers and go, I'm going to write the definitive guide, the definitive biography of the Beatles, it'll have to be 3 volumes, because it's going to be that definitive. I wonder if he kicks himself. That he didn't go, it'll be 10 volumes, one a year.
15 volumes.
Yeah, there'll be like a 400-page book every few years rather than a 1,000-page book every 8 years or 10 years or however long it's sort of been.
No, it's there's a competition between Game of Thrones fans and Beatles fans to see which of their messiahs is going to die off before finishing the, you know.
Oh, no, it's I know many a Beatle fan who lives in fear of checking the news one day and finding that poor Mark is no longer with us with his work unfinished.
Maybe George R.R. Martin would have to finish it off for us. You know? Oh, my gosh.
Every time he does a talk, people are like, oh, is he looking well? Oh, he's looking all right. He's looking healthy. That's good.
it's the same look you give Mick Jagger whenever you see him dancing on the first night of a tour. It's like, is he going to break a hip? Or... no, he's still got it? Okay, wicked. Now, just as a quick aside, I want to compliment you on the title for this book, Love and Let Die. Absolutely incredible title. I love
shameless,
a good
isn't it? Bloody shameless. On. It was originally, I sold it, called Happiness is a Warm Gun, right?
Even!
No, and I thought, that's a cool title. I imagine writing a book called Happiness is a Warm Gun. I like that. But you did then have to explain to people what it was. And then when it just came to me that, I should call it Love and Let Die, I thought, I can't. That's just too odd. It's just too right. It's
all just loves the title.
So
I know he
shameless.
He loves it.
And I remember I had lunch with my publisher and I thought, back in my mind as we were talking, I was going, should I just mention this possible title? I shouldn't, should I? But I did. And she was like, yeah, that's it. That's the title. That's what we're doing. And once it was there, it was so obviously exactly what the book was, exactly what the book was about. And people just got it. People just sort of got the book from that it had to be that. But it's kind of like I've made a bit of a rod for my back with that book, because now the publisher's like, why don't you write something like Live and Let Die, which people would want to buy? You know, having accidentally come up with something that's like insanely commercial, I sort of feel I have to try and follow that. I can't just...
Well, it's funny you say that, because I've got a couple of titles for your future works that
go on. Lovely.
Dr. Nowhere Man.
Oh, okay,
Sky Fall, My Loving.
Uh-huh.
The Man with the Golden Slumbers. Octopussy's Garden.
I was waiting for that. That's the one I always go. Octopussy's Garden is the one.
Tomorrow Never Knows or Dies.
Yeah.
And For No One's Eyes Only.
I love that of all the film titles, they're all taken from Fleming. All the James Bond film titles came from Fleming until they'd totally run out of anything usable. And so person that they went to was Ringo, and they get that Tomorrow Never Dies became, you know, Tomorrow Never, they took it from Tomorrow Never Knows. So that's another of the little sort of crossover coincidences that just seems a bit too good to be true, just too perfect.
And I'm sure Sheryl Crow, who sung the song, has featured on several Ringo solo albums as well. The connections just keep on coming.
There were so many in the later books where, I don't know, George Harrison's relationship with Patty would be coming apart, or Ringo would be splitting with Maureen. And it's always, they'd just come back from a party at Roger Moore's house.
Oh, that's funny. Recently, I had David Rees on the show to talk about his book, Beatles 63. And something that I mentioned then was the idea that most people seem to have an affinity for the middle or latter era of the music, but it's the early two or three years that are actually the most interesting to both read and write about.
Yeah.
Would you agree?
I would certainly agree that they're fascinating. Mm-hmm.
But more so?
I don't know. It's probably easier to get a good paragraph out of the breakup years than it is you know, it's just on a human level.
Okay.
But the psychedelic peaks of, you know, Magical Mystery Tour and Sgt. Pepper and stuff, how could you not want to explore those? How could you not want to write about all that sort of stuff? I'm not going to pick one. They're all valid. I mean, if you look at a film like Backbeat, it's great. It's just clearly great.
There's something I wanted to mention that I forgot earlier. There's another structural element to your book, which is this element of a ticking bomb, which felt very Hitchcockian. Like, yes, I'm going to put this bomb under the table.
Yes.
Here we are. What's the specific wording? Oh, yeah, initiate countdown, detonate aftermath, and then grow up 007. When did that idea for those particular chapters?
Yeah, those are, but it's basically, the book is divided into four parts, but instead of being part one, part two, part three, and part four, it is exactly what you said. And it was, because it was quite a long book, and it wasn't originally like that. I think it was my publisher who said, I think you divide it up into bits because, I don't know, it's just something, it's just for the reader, it's sort of more manageable, you know. And especially because the first few chapters are kind of like, that's just about Ringo, or that's just about Ian Fleming. They don't cross over until the band, the records and the film start to come out. So having that first, under the heading Initiate Countdown, it sort of gave it a sort of a prequel sort of vibe. And then, you know, the rest are self-evident, I think. I didn't quite like Grow Up 007 for the last chunk.
Yeah, channeling your inner Llewellyn Davis there.
Yes. Yeah, he's fascinating because, he's absolutely necessary because those films need someone who's not impressed by James Bond.
That's so true, actually.
Everyone's like, oh, wow, James Bond. It would just be awful. But he just thinks he's an idiot. And to have that ingredient in there is so necessary. It's so sort of important. But there's something about Robert Llewellyn that no one comes out of those films going, oh, he's an arms dealer. You know, he's making all these weapons of mass destruction. And sort of, yeah. That guy's got blood on his hands. It's just like, oh, lovely Q.
Yeah. The new Q is all right. But I don't think Llewellyn Davis would take a USB key from a supervillain and plug it into the mainframe of MI6, though. I feel like someone sort of been watching The Dark Knight or The Avengers.
Yeah.
And we need Silver, Javier Bardem's character, to escape.
Yeah.
And we need this to happen. There was definitely a sense of that.
Definitely. In the new novel by what's her name? Kim Sherwood, Q is a supercomputer, quantum computer, and there's a bunch of people, young people sort of around him, or it sort of working it, but I wonder if that's something that they may sort of go for in the next iteration.
Oh, and you just have, and it's almost like Iron Man where he cues constantly in his ear and...
you can see all that sort of stuff.
Oh my gosh,
yeah. But
well, you know, that actually brings me quite nicely to my next question. Bond and the Beatles have both had to alter and update themselves over the years, but it is clear that Bond's had to do the most updating.
Yeah.
Why do you think this is? Is it just because one's film and one's music?
Well, Bond, the thing about Bond is it has this weird way of sort of almost seductively just whispering to you, sort of going, wouldn't you like your life to be like this? You know, it's like, wouldn't you like to be like, No one fantasizes about being Jason Bourne or anything like that. But the thing
that would be horrible, wouldn't it? Yeah, yeah.
The thing is, oh, you want to be like Bond. And it's not a character, it's not how men should be, and it's not how men need to be, but it's what sort of men sort of fantasize about being or dream of sort of being.
Desires, yeah.
So and in many ways it's ideologically unsound, and being exposed to the light in that way and explored in that way, you can, you know, the faults of it are very, very evident. But by doing that, I do think it is healthy, and I do think the question of how men think they would like to be or what men should be, if you look at the last 60 years of Bond, you can see that changing very, very significantly. And it is moving in a way that is ultimately positive, I think, if you go from the very beginning up to the Daniel Craig sort of films. It is a positive shift. And it's always behind the curve, and it's never, you know, it's never, no one's ever
going to sort Bond of... is always politically correct 5 years ago.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. But that is the area where real change happens. You know, that's when things sort of reach the level that even Bond is changed by them, you know. So it's a good sort of indicator of how we're changing. And so for Bond to keep going, it has to keep doing that. So which is why I think they're having so much difficulty coming up with the next one, because, you know, they finished the last film in 2019. That's 4 years ago. We would have had...
Oh,
you know,
don't say that. Oh, yeah. My God.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm so old.
They haven't even announced, you know, who they're going to be. And they seem to be really struggling because they've got this issue where...
Yeah, do you go for Harry Styles or Arnold Schwarzenegger? Those are your options right now, aren't they?
Basically. And it's a divide. Their audience has been getting older. And the younger audience has not been going to see Daniel Craig films. And, you know, you go to Comic Con and no one's cosplaying as Bond. It's they sort of lost that sort of younger audience. But they are going to need to try and get it back if it is to continue in the long term. So it's the next Bond is going to be a man in his early 30s. It's going to be a millennial. It's going to be the first millennial Bond. Now, that's very, very different to the visions of masculinity. These are people who've grown up with, you know, Tinder or hookup apps or something like that. And the way that Bond's sluttiness was supposedly classy in yes. Fleming's eyes. Oh, that's so far gone, man. It's so vanilla.
Yeah, there was no such thing as a man-ho in 1973, for example. Yeah. You know, I mean, are we... Because I'm never going to use the W-O-K-E word around Bond or Beatles, because I think it's a ridiculous term that yeah. is just a distillation of 100,000 feelings that...
Well, if people had a rule that you could use that word if you defined what you meant by that word, yeah. we'd be fine. But it's just everyone using it in different ways and meaning yeah. different things, it becomes meaningless.
Because, I mean, I think one of the best things the Bond franchise has done in recent years was to add a competent woman writer to yeah. the scripts. And the only bad thing I'll say about No Time to Die script is you can tell which scenes Phoebe Waller-Bridge wrote. You can tell yes. which scenes were from the 2017 script and the 2018 yeah. script. And yeah. that's not a particularly bad thing. They just needed they should have just smoothed it over a little bit, so it was less of a like that. But I feel like it was a very good move for the group for the franchise, but that's because they've got to continually put out new product. Bond can't survive as a franchise just having Dr. No up to you know, You Only Live Twice or something. The Beatles have those albums,
yeah,
and that's it. There's yeah, nothing more.
Absolutely.
So the difference would be, if you don't like Run For Your Life, which is about killing a woman because, you know, you don't like her romantic interests.
Yeah.
You simply have to just not like that song, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah.
With Bond, it's easier to update and rejuvenate him rather than, say, rejuvenate a Beatles song, because you can't do that. I guess, yeah. you know. Diametrically opposed.
Ahead of the last film, that word you don't want to say,
yeah.
It wasn't enough for the Daily Mail, right? They had to invent the word.
For heaven forbid that yeah. there is a woman of colour with the rank of 007. Firstly, who cares? Like, this is all like, you're a writer, I'm a podcaster, but ultimately, yeah. at the end of the day, yeah. who cares?
They coined the word super woke.
So
described the last Bond film. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, they did. And it's a Bond film we're talking about. It's mad, isn't it?
In rebuttal to that, though, I felt like they didn't take the racial element of the bad guy far enough.
Okay.
I wanted the bad guy
guy?
You know, the doctor who was working for Safin and is like, oh, this can target any group or any race on the planet.
Oh,
yeah. And the implication was like, oh, is this bad guy just trying to kill all Filipino people or something like that?
Sure.
Fortunately,
yeah.
my audience in the Philippines is very small, so I'm not going to be offending anyone. But, you know, I kind of felt like if we're going to make Bond maybe a bit more acceptable in today's society, maybe make the villains even more unacceptable.
Yeah,
not
yeah,
just,
absolutely.
I want money, power, and real estate. Like, fuck off, Lex Luthor. You know, you know what I mean. Like, the real the real enemies Bond should be fighting are, you know, racial purists and people like that. You know, like, let's give Bond a 20. I don't want to say is I'm going to be James Bond. He's a bad spy. It's our fake news. You know, well, let's have that be the villain. You know,
well, Danny Boyle was supposed to be doing that last film.
It was never going to happen. It's like Marvel and having Edgar Wright do Ant-Man. It was never going to happen because Danny Boyle's got something to say, and you can't say anything in Bond.
Yeah. Well, it was a lot more about Russia meddling in other countries. And
specifically
these are the problems of the modern world. So they did that. They wiped all that away because for them, there's this weird little fantasy world that Bond has, which is sort of important.
That's Dying of the Day there. Is the final time a country's the villain, isn't it?
Die Another Day. It was North Korea. Yeah, it was North Korea.
It's almost like how like gypsies or redheads are the only things you can take the mick out of in this country anymore. Right. You know, like
I'm not sure you can do that, to be honest.
I'm being flippant, but you know, back when Dying of the Day came out, it was like, oh well, North Korea is the only like bad country we can pick. That's not Islamic, for example, because Bond's never going to touch that. Bond is never going anywhere near the Middle East.
Yeah.
Because that's very pointed and that would never work. But then again,
Die Another Day is fascinating because
it is. It's going such a transitionary.
It's heading towards Marvel territory. It's got this
The wave and the laser and
but the villain's got this sort of robotic exosuit which allows him to control a space laser that can destroy any part of the world. This is pure Marvel sort of thing, and they just sort of made such a handbrake turn at that point and went, no, we cannot go down the invisible cars, ice hotels, and that sort of pure sort of fantasy route.
Dude, your bit in this book where you talk about why the Jinx movie didn't work was very funny.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah, no. I mean, if you can't make a movie about Halle Berry in a skin-tight leather cat suit work, I don't know how bad of a premise your film is. Because Catwoman got made, you know? Yeah. You know, she's done Monsters Ball. She'll do any crap now, you know.
She deserves a payday.
Yeah, 100%. Of course, there is a fantastic quote in the book that I really resonated with. And it was when you wrote, "The four Beatles then appear like modern people marooned in this distant past, waiting for a society to catch up with them."
Oh, yes. Yeah, in Get Back, you mean? I was talking about Get Back, wasn't I? Yeah. And that you spend, you know, hours and hours hanging out with them, and you understand how they relate to each other, and it seems very normal. And then the cameras on the last episode go outside. And
hello!
Headscarves. And it's just like, my God, this is the ancient past. What are those people doing in the ancient past?
Do you think that society has caught up with them yet?
Yeah, I think we've been very much shaped by them, and I think that is the way they resonate with us in Get Back, and the way we sort of understand their how they're thinking and how they're behaving with each other, and how emotionally sort of informed they are. I do think we have moved in that direction. Definitely, I think there's not many people like them at the time. It's that. You know, there's only 6.5 years between cover on Please, Please Me and Abbey Road. But the four strange hairy men on Abbey Road look nothing like the bright-faced young boys on Please, Please Me. And it's not that there weren't anyone like that at the time. It's that the people like how the Beatles were at the end of the 60s were just unthinkable back in 1962. The people who had those... you know, views on, you know, on religion, on drugs, on sexuality, on all these sort of, all the things that they define them, all the things that we think about when we think of their work, just simply didn't exist at that point.
I mean, reading your book, it reminded me a lot of, like, when I was younger, I've got my mother who was an incredible matriarch, very strong woman. My gran on my mother's side, same again.
Yeah.
My dad and my granddad were terrified of my nan on the other side of the family. and my sister, to me, is a kind of Sauron Morgoth figure that I'm eternally afraid of because she's a very strong woman in herself.
Wow.
She's the light of my life, but also the darkness in my soul as well.
okay.
And so
when Does she listen to your podcast at all?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she's never heard a single episode. But so when I grew up, I was like, hang on, people don't like women. People think women are weak or lesser. And I genuinely had to like reconcile with that and come to terms with that. And I feel like I get a lot of that in this book. It's like, if I felt that in the mid-2000s, how were people in 1964 trying to reconcile with these four young lads and their and their kooky ideas?
Yeah.
I mean, you're just talking about England here. You know, you don't even touch on how they wouldn't play to segregated crowds in America.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I think that's in there. But
well, no, I mean, it's not the focus. Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, no, it is it is fascinating about how much it seems to be England trying to decide who it was now that it's no longer empire, looking for a modern sense of country, Britain rather than particularly England. But the fact that that sort of became such a global phenomenon, the fact that the whole world got in on it, is kind of odd. It does say there is something more going on there than just England having a bit of a nervous breakdown.
Well, it's arguably the biggest, simultaneously the biggest revolution in British pop culture and biggest export of British culture and pop culture since, like, I don't know,
ever.
Yeah, like the East India Trading Company and colonialism.
Oh, yeah.
Imagine a band of four guys playing pop tunes has the cultural significance of conquering dozens of countries worldwide. You know what I mean? Like, it's insane that that sentence that I've just said isn't that ridiculous.
It is insane when you read Leslie Woodhead's written a really good book about the Beatles in Russia, how the Beatles conquered the Kremlin. And it's full of, you know, people just going, out of all the Western things, the Beatles was one of the strongest, was one of the greatest things that caused about the end of the Soviet Union, in the fact that because the Soviet system had said the Beatles are bad and tried to ban them and things like that, and people heard them and they were like, well, that's clearly not bad. That's great. That's utterly sort of human. And that's the sort of point they sort of stopped believing in the Soviet system. So when, for lots of economic reasons, it did all collapse and fall apart, nobody fought for it because nobody really believed for it. And all these, you know, Russian commentators going, yeah, that's because of the Beatles, was quite a shock to me, because it seems absurd that their band could.
And there's no irony there. There's no irony there either.
Yeah, no, not at all. And it's funny for me because it's Bond was that great, you know, to destroy the Soviet Union, fight the Soviet Union.
Yes.
You know, but no, it's just some yeahs was there.
No, I mean, I've got like 8 questions that I could pick, and I don't know which one to follow from there. There's so much to cover there.
No, yeah, sorry.
Oh my gosh. No, you know what? Something that we brought up earlier that I wanted to come back to. You mentioned this in passing. Bond and the Beatles have a reliance on what critics who praised the film The King's Speech dubbed the Grey Pound. The Grey Pound.
Oh, right. Oh, yes. Okay.
So that means people over the age of kind of 50 and onwards.
Yeah. Are those people who can afford them bloody 180 quid box sets?
Or if you've got a Patreon where people buy it for you. Yeah. yeah, look, I'm confident that the Beatles are going to be here in 100 years.
I am too.
Do you think Bond's going to be here in 100 years?
It's a fascinating question. It's a really interesting question. On one hand, it's quite interesting when they were recasting Sean Connery. One of the quotes from Cubby Broccoli was that Bond is one of those characters that will be played by lots of actors that will always go on, like Tarzan or Sherlock Holmes.
Yeah.
And now, Sherlock Holmes, sure, that makes sense. But Tarzan, that's not happening anymore.
Oh, no, you know, it's so true.
At the heart of Tarzan is the notion that a white aristocratic baby, if you put that in the jungle, it will become king of the jungle because it's superior, right?
Yeah.
That's at the heart of it. There's no way Tarzan can sort of be resurrected. Nobody.
They tried with Christoph Waltz, no less, as the villain.
They did, and they tried their best, but ain't no Tarzan films out at the moment, put it that way. So it's tempting to say, oh, Bond might be like that.
Sherlock's moved to TV now as well.
Oh, Sherlock's everywhere. Well, that's
good. But could Bond come to television in 20 years in the age of streaming, you know?
It's a good. I was going to say that it's tempting to say that Bond might not make it in the 21st century because the generation raised in the 21st century is pretty much everything they're against, you know. But people have been saying, oh, Bond's over, it's old hat, they should stop doing these things. It's just embarrassing. From about 1967. And it just keeps going, and it just keeps going. And they were saying that for all the 70s and throughout the 80s and the 90s. There's always a reviewer just saying this is... So there's something... maybe it's because it's become a tradition. Tradition is a sort of powerful sort of magic. But there is... I suspect it's going to be... It's not going to... Well, I suspect it's going to continue. It would be interesting on TV because of the way the media landscape shifted. Mm. I'm very surprised that they didn't do a series with the current Bond Scooby Gang after at the end of No Time to Die when Daniel Craig was out.
Oh, okay.
But there was the M and the Q and the Tanner and the Lashana Lynch's 007 and the whole thing, you know, and Money Penny, a really great Money Penny.
Oh, you got Ana de Armas' character, they were talking about her in a
Oh, yeah, movie. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. They might not be able to afford to get her now, they say. But
yeah.
It seems set up for a sort of a good Amazon Prime sort of a spy caper, like they've done the Jack Ryan or the.
I was just going to say Jack Ryan's the big one, yeah.
Easily have done that and then come back with the new Bond with an entirely new team. Even get Timothy Dalton in as M and never explain if he's playing the same character as he was before, because that would really drive people mad.
Obviously, you know that Sean Connery was meant to be Kincaid.
Yes, yes. Spyfall. Well, yes, I think they very quickly realised it was probably a bad idea.
Yeah, it's stupid. It's stupid.
But, yeah, I'd love to see Timothy Dalton back as M. That would work.
Now, this isn't my idea. This is an idea that I've heard various critics and there's actually a guy on YouTube that I'm going to hook you up to if you haven't already heard of him already. Dyson, Dyson's his name. He's got a massive Bond channel. He would fucking love this book. but I think I heard it from him first, the idea that the next Bond, we go back to the 60s.
You hear it a lot. It's a common one. I think was Quentin Tarantino was his plan.
Quentin has definitely said it as well. Yeah, that'd be what he'd do. Maybe like he'd know.
It would work for one. It might work for a couple.
A trilogy, maybe.
But it's not. You know, it does have to keep changing and being relevant to the modern world and reflect what the modern fear is and all these sort of things. To keep going on, to sort of keep going on. But yeah, it's a little sort of breather between, you know, 15 years of Daniel Craig and 15 years of the next guy.
Well, I mean, the big example for me is the gap between Timothy Dalton and Brosnan was perfect. It literally felt like they were going from film to digital, from analog to internet in one fell swoop.
Yeah.
And maybe if you do 10 years of 60s Bond, then after that, we can see what Bond in the era of China being the major world power and AI and all of that stuff.
Yeah.
And he can recontextualize himself again. Either that or 10-year break. Fucking massive 10-year break. Cubby Broccoli can just hold on to his coffers for a bit.
There's certainly a lot of people who would love to see the books made as the books.
What, where Phoenix Lighter gets eaten by sharks? No.
Yeah, he gets eaten by sharks. And it has his hook. He's got his hook. As a TV series, you know, a really sort of faithful adaptation, period adaptation as a TV series. I can see that. I can definitely see the logic of that. We shouldn't be waiting 10 years between Bonds. So it's just insane. It's mad that we've been waiting this long to even hear what's going to happen with the next one.
I mean, there's nothing that would make a Bond series particularly expensive, is there? It's not like Game of Thrones. I mean, it would be period, but I mean, it's not like it wouldn't be on location particularly much. It's mostly suits and cars and coffee tables, things that are still relatively abundant in everyday life.
Yeah, it would be on location a lot, but what isn't these days, you know?
You wouldn't. You just do it in that big Disney screen thing where...
yeah.
Big hollow thing that the Mandalorian used.
And just, you know, in Dr. No, for example, in the book, he kills a villain by drowning him in bird shit. And then he, and just before that, he has a big fight with a squid, right? So to do it as the books, man, that would be fun.
Now, every single one of the books has at least one moment where you go, oh, we know why they didn't do that. Budget limitations.
Oh, is that what you say? Oh, yeah, yeah.
But there's no scene in a Bond book that would require more than 10 extras on set at any one time, really, is there?
Yeah, often the Bond books are much smaller. I mean, Moonraker, he just knocks around Kent for a bit. He never leaves Kent.
Oh, you know?
Yeah. None of this going into space or, you know, sort of South American jungle or anything like that.
Oh, that's funny. I'm just picturing the trailer. In a world, one man wanders round Kent for a bit.
One man, he drives the A2.
One man stops at a lay-by for a Griggs. Oh, right, dude. One last question, one last serious one, and then we'll start wrapping things up, chucking in the plugs here and there.
Righto.
Connery and the Beatles were both working class in the 60s. At the time, one of the largest working class cultural revolutions in history. Where do you think society or we would be socially without these two beacons of make something of yourselfness?
Yeah, I mean, that's such a significant part of the book. I don't even know where to sort of begin on that and how it all sort of fell apart, especially after the 90s and how that sort of brief period where in acting, in music, in theatre, working class voices sort of finally were allowed in. It was a really brief period. And a lot had to do with how the culture got, the country got mixed up during the war. And, you got, people who would never be heard of sort of emerged after the war. So like the Goons and the Spike Milligan and people like that. And it was so threatening to the establishment. I talk about how Hanif Qureshi, when he was at school, he was taught that the Beatles were a hoax because there was no way that, you know, four oiks, basically, who weren't from the right families and who didn't go to the right schools, there's no way that they could create music that was self-evidently better than anything that the people from the right schools were coming up with. The thought of it was just so threatening to Hanif Qureshi's music teacher that he had to retreat into this conspiracy theory where it was George Martin and Brian Epstein who were writing the songs and they were just all, you know, hard to sort of please the women. And you see the reaction when Harold Wilson put the Beatles up for MBEs and the appalled letters that flooded into the Times and the Telegraph and people sending back their honours and think that our honours system had been devalued by being associated with, you know, working class Liverpudlians. It was such a jolt and such a change. And slowly it's gone away again. It's all sort of fallen away again. And the sense that, you know, if there's a musician and you know, you hear nowadays, if you go to their Wikipedia page, you know,
their mum, their dad, yeah.
Their mum, their dad, their school will all be hyperlinked. You know, it's that sort of where we're sort of coming from. And it's such a shame. It's a real shame because what was so vital about voices like the Beatles were because they were from outside the establishment. They wanted to change things. They wanted things to be better. People who were from the status quo, quite happy with the status quo. They don't want to change it at all. So it's much more anodyne, you know, it's much more sort of blander and more ineffectual and much more meaningless sort of culture that sort of comes from a lot of people. But the fact is, you know, if you're starting out in music, in acting, in even in writing, you're going to need to live in London for a few years before you make anything. And that costs so much. So you can only do that if you have the family backing and all these things.
Dude, I am bitter to this day that I never got my paid for internship at the BBC. You know, these things don't happen. But I mean, isn't a lot of this, you know what, I'm going to become Citizen Smith here. I'm going to raise my hand to the sky. Mm-hmm. Isn't this just down to the fact that it's the post-50s boom, the post-80s economic boom? And so, you know, the Beatles and, say, Britpop, they're spawned from these eras of an economic slump, and then things start looking better. 9/11's, you know, a glint in our eye in the future, so everything's great in the 90s, and so there's loads of music, loads of culture, loads of film. And now suddenly, post-war on terror, post-economic collapse, oh, all of the biggest actors are now Benedict Cumberbatch, Eton, Tom Hiddleston, Oxford. Even all of the singers now, I mean, half the people you see in pop bands and stuff, oh, well, their dad's was a producer in the 80s, or their mother is, you know, a very important executive at Geffen Records or something.
I mean, it's interesting that the younger generation have picked up on this in a way that
Nepo
our generation
babies.
Did. Knowing stuff about Nepo babies and things like that. It's a
5-year-old.
Ooh, hello. Sorry.
That was a... Carry on. Nepo babies.
Yes, a strange alien voice bit. They're clued into it. They understand it and they're aware of it, which is, I find, promising. But it's a terrible state of affairs. I cannot solve for you now in 5 minutes. I'm sorry, Sam.
No, but do you not think that, mate, let's look at this in a more positive light. Surely that means that we're on the cusp of another great, you know, surge of pop culture and music and movies and stuff, you know.
That would be bloody lovely.
It'd be lovely, wouldn't it, if there was a new Oasis that everyone loved and then everyone would say it is as good as the Beatles, and then people like me would say, well, no, they're not quite as good as the Beatles, but, you know, blah, 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 blah.
It's, the culture in Generation Z is fascinating, but we're utterly excluded from it. It's incomprehensible to us. It's got so many layers upon layers and references upon references that unless you're immersed in that particular world, you cannot follow it. You cannot understand what is going on. But I think it's rich, and I think it's really fascinating what's happening there. But for, you know, old farts like myself, you could turn on TikTok and just go, it's just people shouting, I don't like it. it's not very good. I think we're sort of we're missing. There's a lot of there's a surprising depth of thought, I find, in Generation Z culture. I'm quite clued up on a lot of things, so it's no surprise that they pick up on things like the Nepo babies in a way that the millennials didn't, and things like that.
Yeah, I feel like millennialism was almost a nihilistic acceptance of the status quo.
Okay.
And I think Gen Z's a bit more, nah, the rebels blew up the Death Star, man. Like,
yeah.
Like,
definitely.
Let's go for it. But, you know, one thing that I just did want to say was, you know, the book covers so much. Folks, this is the book right here. The book covers so much, and yet there's a wonderful balance you strike in it in between hard-hitting facts and the narrative that you're setting out. And you've got these wonderfully brief chapters. I felt like my reading picked up. I felt like I was always desiring to find out what happened next, what year you were going to pick. Was it going to be a Beatles chapter? Was it going to be a Bond? Was it going to be either or? I generally found myself excited and wanting to progress in the book outside of just having content to talk to you about on this plug interview. You know, I really was actually enjoying going through it. It's something that I'm actually going to finish in my own time. I'm not going to say I'm going to finish it in the next 2 weeks. I'm not saying that. But, you know, next holiday I have, this is going right in the suitcase. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have a little margarita going, oh, my God, in context, McCartney's promotion of ordinariness. A bit, you know.
Sam, that's a lovely thing. That's a lovely thing.
Folks, I mean, I'll give my full glowing review in the pre-recorded segment that comes at the top of this, because I don't want to embarrass you too much. But this is a wonderful example of what modern Beatles new media looks like. It's not just, here's all the facts that you already know. You know, here's all the things that these five other previous biographers said in slightly different syntax. This is the modern synthesis of Beatles media. This is Beatles and Beatles plus Beatles with. Does it recontextualise my entire way of viewing the band? I don't think many books do that. But does it offer me something new that I haven't read before in a Beatles text? Something that's enjoyable and actually quite funny in places? Yes, it is. And for that reason, I love your fucking book, mate. It's really bloody good, Sam. You should do this for a living.
Thank you, man. That's very kind.
Although, reading this book, I imagine that whoever wrote this knows nothing about William Blake. That's all I'll say. Mm. That's all I'm going to say. Look, John, thank you so much for coming on to Paul or Nothing. We're already about 25 minutes to half an hour over from what I intended to keep you.
Yeah.
Hey, you know, you are clearly as a digressional man as myself, so we're both going to rein it in now. We're both going to be professional. Do you have any plugs, or is this our goodbyes, my friend?
This is our goodbyes. Now, enough plugs. No one needs more plugs. But it's been great talking to Sam. Really, really enjoyed it.
Thank you very much, dude. This has been another episode of Paul and Nothing. Place to get all of your Paul all of the time. Forget Live and Let Die. This was Love and Let Die. Peace and love, peace and love. No more autographs. Play us out, Danny.
Sad.